Good morning, everyone. My introduction is my name is Elliot. Today I will be sharing my topic on muscle monitoring using our new sensor, flexible and wearable sensor. We have the current method we're using for muscle monitoring is there's a few of them. There's EMG, there's MMG, or there's some really method which is PMG. PMG we can measure the muscle measure the dispersion of the muscle while contracting using those parameters to calculate the muscle properties. And using those properties we can find out the condition of the muscle, including is the muscle fiber type and also the condition of the particular muscle. So we could determine, for example, we could see the contraction velocity and including with the contraction time, which is right here. So understanding those parameters, we can help to determine how the condition of the muscle. At the same time, we could help to diagnose it with different diseases and help to see the potential application of this. So the application including the surface training. So for example, there's a very unique experiment recently on soccer player. So while in soccer player, the top player has to train for over months and months. So the coach can also use this technique, the PMG technique, to understand how the improvement of the muscle during the training. So if the training is successful or the training is not really working well. So another experiment has been done with PMG is to detect with the population of muscle of the muscle. So during injury, the muscle will contract slightly slower than usual, and by monitoring long term, we could find out how well the muscle is being recovered. And at the same time, we can also tell if the technology, what the treatment is actually effective or not. However, this PMG has been a few problems, including with motion artifacts. So the patient has to stay still on the bed, and at the same time, has to be carefully monitoring without any other motion, without any motion or any movement. So this could be causing a lot of measurement error while doing the test. So in order to eliminate this motion artifact, the person will have to either sit still or stand on the bed. And at the same time, because this is a spine load sensor, so the muscle will be tightly encoded on top of them while doing the motion, while doing the experiment. So we have designed a new sensor, which is the one over here. Which is the one over here. This is using PVDF material, which is different from the traditional ultrasonic probe, which is usually the original sensors we're using with this PVDF, which is very resistant, and it's really hard to measure continuously. At the same time, it's very hard to hold onto it. So it's really hard to put on top of the muscle at the same time. It's difficult to measure. So this device that we made is really thin. It's 110 micrometer. At the same time, it's flexible, so it could put on top of the skin without too much interference. This is a bit more insight on this sensor. The sensor is using the PVDF polymer, and which is flexible and it's wearable. And the weight is only 0.2 grams, so it's relatively light compared to other sensors. This is the overall measurement principle in using the wearable sensor, ultrasonic sensor. And the model here shows smaller field still is the general idea of the perception industry with a pulse field sensor. It is using process remote, so the sensor sends a pulse and then receives backwards to the same sensor. And by understanding and knowing the time delay between the starting point of the sensor sending the signal and receiving, we could calculate the displacement, or actually we could calculate the thickness of the particular piece. So we have developed our ultrasound sensor, how we can test it. We test it on the sample, we test it on how the accuracy goes, how accurate we can get in terms of the measurement. So we made a phantom, which is using a Carleton-based phantom. And the Carleton-based phantom has very close acrylic properties compared with soft tissue. So we could compare with a very controlled environment. And how we can simulate the phantom system is not movable. So we use a circuit motor to keep pushing with different rates. We're pushing the phantom with different speeds of sleep and also the fitness changes as well. So by measuring using the wearable ultrasonic sensor, we can measure the fitness changes, and we can use the laser to measure the distance from the laser to the surface of the phantom to do it as a gold standard to compare the two display the two pictures. So laser has really high accuracy, which is close to 15 nanometer. So we can with such a high accuracy, we can confirm the accuracy of our ultrasonic sensor. And the diagram here shows the measurement with laser and our ultrasonic sensor, and it shows the agreement between the two measurements. And by doing a bit more calculation, we find out that with different frequency and different control environment, we actually find out that other sensors have less than 6 micrometer accuracy. So after we know the accuracy is high enough to monitor muscle motion, so we proceed to our in vivo experiment. We have put it on. We have to put a screen stimulus tab. We have to now a young adult with from 23 to 25 years old, and we stimulate the muscle during the experiment. So we use the UNS. You can see the UNS reactors here with all of with a device which stimulates from 2 hertz to 30 hertz. And after obtaining the RF signal, we continue and we did some processing and then we use positive in order to tracking method to calculate the displacement. So this from the results we got from here, we got we go from 2 hertz to 16 hertz. So at 2 hertz, the muscle is contracted and then slowly relaxed and continuous. We can obtain those important parameters in here. We can obtain the contraction velocity. We can also obtain other muscle contractions from 2 hertz or 4 hertz. And afterwards, when the EMS frequency increases, we find out we also obtain when the muscle receives a lot higher frequency, the muscle contracts more rapidly. At the same time, it's no longer relaxed. So at the point that when the muscle can no longer relax, we call that tetanic contraction. From this graph here, it's really difficult to see when tetanic contraction is happening. We can see there's a muscle still keeping contracting, and there's some small little relaxation from higher frequency that's really difficult to tell. So we use a common method to find out when is the time that when is the best frequency will get the tetanic contraction. We're using a method which is called patient index. Patient index calculates the relaxation time and the relaxation distance, and then comparing the relaxation distance and consistency. By doing that, we can find out when the potential system happens. Potential system happens, usually we will consider as nanoseconds of when transition in that happens. So at after 90%, we can consider there's no other the muscle is no longer able to contract further, or it is reaches its maximum length. And by knowing the minimum frequency that we evoke during contraction, we actually can be able to find out the muscle fiber type. So, for example, slow muscle will have a lower system index, a minimum frequency that evokes pattern contraction, and fast muscle has a higher tolerance in terms of high frequency. So after we with three subjects, we calculate on the displacement graph, and then we obtain these three contraction parameters. One of them is the contraction time, and the second one is the minimum frequency that we evoke for the contraction. And then we can see we have a very good alignment, because as we have speak of, the contraction time is related to the minimum frequency that we evoke for the contraction. As the contraction time increases, the minimum frequency that we evoke for the contraction actually lower. So it's on the opposite side. And so far, the three subjects obtained from the agreement. However, we still need to further investigate on these parameters, because they get better results. And in conclusion, we have investigated using our ultrasonic sensor to measure the accuracy. And often we're using a phantom, and we also successfully obtained the motion of monitoring the muscle contraction evoked by the EMS frequency. And for the future, we're planning to investigate more on these effects, and we will obtain more different other people, and hopefully we can investigate more on this.